On this episode of Out of Left Field, the stories of two Hazleton natives who got to live out their dreams in Florida. One threw out the first pitch at a Yankee spring training game, and the other raced around the Daytona International Speedway. Plus, the Hazleton Area High School bowling team helps me try and live my dream of athletic triumph. Get stretched, get pumped. Here comes Out of Left Field.
Out of Left Field is brought to you in part by Coordinated Health Hazleton Campus. Better together.
Well, here we are back out in left field looking for some interesting local sports stories. Thanks for joining me. I'm Ken Cara. We have two in-depth interviews coming your way and one traditional Out of Left Field feature story. Throwing out the first pitch is a story about throwing out the first pitch. Here's an interview I did with United States Congressman Lou Barletta just a few days after he tossed out the first pitch at Steinbrenner Field in Tampa Bay, Florida, before a Red Sox-Yankees spring training game. So happy to be with Congressman Lou Barletta from the 11th District in Pennsylvania, but was very busy in Florida throwing out the first pitch at a Yankees-Red Sox game. Now, I came in here, I meant no disrespect, I'm wearing the Red Sox hat, but I wanted to prove a point. Before we get to the game, is there political correctness? I mean, do you feel you have constituents who are Red Sox fans? You're a big Yankees fan, but do you have a problem saying Red Sox stink, or how does that go?
No, I'm a diehard Yankee fan. I don't care where I'm at. That's, you know, I grew up as a Yankee fan, and you can't leave your team for politics over politics. It's just the way it is. I mean, look at Chris Christie. He got himself in trouble because, you know, he was a Dallas Cowboy fan, but you are what you are.
So you go down, I absolutely love that answer, and there you go. So you go down to Florida, and in the past, I covered you in the congressional baseball game. I watched you pitch. You did a great job in that game. They asked you to throw out the first pitch, and you said you were feeling pretty confident, but all of a sudden, some people got in your head. They just kept mentioning the word bounce.
They did. Everyone I said that I was throwing the first pitch, they kept saying, well, don't bounce it. And, you know, I didn't think twice until I kept hearing this over and over and over again. And assistant public relations director for the Yankees tried to talk me into throwing in front of the mound because he thought I couldn't reach. And he said, no, you don't want to bounce it. Whatever you do, don't bounce it. And I said, no, I come from northeastern Pennsylvania. If they see me throwing in front of the mound, you know, they'll make fun of me. I got a pitch from the mound. He said, well, it's a big mistake. You're making a big mistake. The last one to do that was Donald Trump, and he threw it right into the ground. And 10,000 people yelled, you're fired.
Now, you had the pressure on you, too, because this was Red Sox-Yankees, and even spring training, that's a big game. And you said it was a record crowd.
It was a record crowd, and on my way to the field, I had to go down the elevator, and Yankee announcer Michael Kay was in the elevator, and they told him I was throwing out the first pitch, and he said, Congressman, I just want to give you one piece of advice. Whatever you do, don't bounce it. So then I got to the mound and I start questioning myself. And Joe Girardi sent the catcher out as a young player, actually played in Scranton Wilkes-Barre last year. He asked me, he said, so you're going to pitch in front of the mound, right? And I said, no, I'm going to pitch from the mound. He said, man, whatever you do, don't bounce it. And as I walked out onto the field, you know, there was at least 12,000 people there. I was really wondering if this was the right thing to do. I hadn't warmed up. I didn't throw a ball in 8 months, and you know, maybe they were right. So I just went out. I got right onto the mound. I turned around and I fired a strike.
Incredible. You see how many warm-up pitches relief pitchers get who don't even go into games. They sent you out there cold, and it was interesting. You said they actually called over to Joe Girardi when they found out that you were going to throw from the mound to go get the catcher.
Yeah, he did. And you know, when he said Rodriguez, go catch him, I got all excited thinking Alex Rodriguez was going to catch me. It turned out to be Eddie Rodriguez, number 70 in your scorecard. But you know, it was still a thrill for me.
You got to play in that congressional baseball game at Nationals Park, but where does this rank? I mean, Steinbrenner Field, as a huge Yankees fan, I'm sure you got to see some of the other Yankees around there. How would you just sum up the experience?
It's a once-in-a-lifetime thing. I mean, you know, to throw out the first pitch, you know, in a Yankee-Red Sox game, even if it was spring training, is still a big deal for me, who was a lifelong Yankee fan. You know, to be part of that is something that I'll never forget. And most likely, other people would not forget it either if I did bounce it. But lucky for me, I didn't. So the only one who will remember this will probably be me.
Unbelievable story. And I wonder, who's your favorite Yankee pitcher of all time?
My favorite Yankee pitcher is Ron Guidry. You know, I was a Gator fan, and you know, he had some incredible seasons, 25-3 in his big year. So he's my favorite Yankee pitcher.
And just two more questions. One is, I was thinking of this: if you were a relief pitcher or a position player, and you're coming to the plate, what would your song be? Your at bat song or your song coming out?
Probably Tom Petty, "I Won't Back Down."
That's a good choice. Very good choice. I had Mariano Rivera's song on me, Inter Sandman, and Red Sox fan. That's what you did to me today, Congressman. All I thought about was Mo and the pain he caused me as a Red Sox fan.
Well, you know, this was a second thrill for me. I had tried out with the Cincinnati Reds in my much younger days, and prior to the tryout, I went to Bucky Dent's baseball school. So I played for 2 months at Bucky Dent's baseball school, and I actually got to meet him again just this year at an event in Washington. So I got a signed ball from Bucky Dent, and I hate to bring that name up with somebody wearing a Red Sox hat, but
You know, we have a different name for him. He has a middle name to all Red Sox fans, and
well,
in that part,
you know, the jersey I wore, I also, you know, I know this might be a sore subject with Red Sox fans, but I decided to wear a jersey that they could associate themselves with. So I wore number 3, Babe Ruth, who the Red Sox traded to the Yankees for, I think, a small sum of money, and Ruth had a mediocre career after that.
So having a great day until I came here, Congressman. Thank you so much. Very last thing, how important is it for your constituents, for everybody, to see politicians get out there and show, listen, you love baseball, and it's a huge part of our, it's a huge part of America.
Yeah, I'm a baseball fan first and a politician second. I mean, grew up with, you know, watching the Yankees and playing baseball, and it's a national pastime, and there's nothing better. And I think, you know, you could put all politics aside when you're watching you're watching Major League Baseball players, and you know, especially a spring training game, you know, it's the field of dreams for these kids, you know, who just wish that one day they can make it to the, you know, to the big show and watch how they're playing. So it's still, you know, I think politics comes in second, definitely, to baseball.
Up next, a story that will put every sports movie you've seen recently to shame except Creed. Check out My Day with the Hazleton Area Bowling Team.
Out of Left Field is brought to you in part by Coordinated Health Hazleton Campus. Better together.
Welcome back to the action and excitement of Out of Left Field. Recently, the Hazleton Area Bowling Team invited me to come and practice with them. It was fun and a bit overwhelming. I don't think people realize all these young men and women go through to excel in their sport. Just thinking about everything the coaches and kids told me almost made my head explode as I stepped up to take my shot. Luckily, my head is still intact and I can deliver the full story safely to you.
Stuck at a job where he has to witness others' athletic triumphs on a daily basis, Ken Cara is haunted by his past.
This is where my life changed, the Butler Township Community Park. I was playing midfield for the Bishop AP soccer team on the right wing. 3 guys surrounded me. Instead of kicking the ball out for a throw-in, I decided to go backwards, maybe give it up for a corner kick, and I kicked the ball right into my own goal, and that's what people remember about my athletic career.
But what if all that could change? What if it wasn't too late for redemption?
You got a part of what we drill to do at every practice. What you saw competitively, the nerves, the anxiety when you're going up, and you have your teammates relying on you on the team portion. And, you know, yeah, there's a couple falls, there's a couple fallbacks, there's ditches, there's everything else, but like I tell these kids, you got the three critical components you need to do. One, believe in yourself, because you can make the change. Two, believe in your teammates, because you can affect that change when you compete. And lastly, believe in your coach, because right then and there, he's the guiding person that gets you to where you need to be at that competitive level.
What if a former Bishop Hafey Viking was welcomed by some Hazleton area Cougars for one last shot at greatness?
Who are we?
Cougars!
Who are we?
Cougars!
Team on three!
One, two, three, team!
From the mind that brought you Police Cow comes a story of inspiration.
I came here and I saw some people had nicknames, so I want a nickname before I go out there. But do you have a nickname?
I can give you a nickname if you'd like one.
Okay, off the top of your head, what would you call me?
The Gutter Gang.
No! No!
Imagine being invited over someone's house for dinner and the first thing you do is drop their great-grandmother's serving bowl and break it into 1,000 pieces. That's how my time started with the Hazleton Area Bowling Team.
No. Oh. Terrible.
Bad start.
Awful.
Bad start. Other than hitting the rack thing, how did that go?
Oh, it was a beautiful shot, but the rack was in the way and it wasn't your fault.
With no place to go but up, I trudged along with the support of my team, although my slow start continued.
One at a time.
I overheard head coach Sean Evans saying that hitting the 7-pin is part of a training program, and that made me feel pretty good until I talked to Tyler Herbinko.
That's not terrible at all for us. For you, that's really bad.
Okay, why?
Well, you only got 1 out of 10 pins, and that's a nice 10%. Which is failing in most of your classes, so try again next time.
I started looking for any possible excuse for my start.
Wheel!
Yeah.
Harry,
come
on. Oh. What was that all about? So, why is no one else wearing jeans? Is this against uniform, or is it just kids aren't wearing jeans anymore?
Well, kids are wearing jeans, but I don't find jeans comfortable while I bowl.
All right, so that might be part of my problem.
Yeah, probably. That's probably the reason.
I sensed some sarcasm, and that excuses weren't going to cut it. Things were going pretty bad, and then Evans offered this critique.
A sumo wrestler could bowl.
Yeah.
He got your movements down pat.
All right.
I needed help, and fast. So I turned to my teammate and Cougar Boys co-captain, Zachary Bergerson, who looks extremely cool when he bowls.
When I started out, I kind of looked like you. I looked pretty funny. It's not normal to start with like your legs spread out like that. It's kind of normal to keep them together, keep your whole body in a line. Like if there's a pole going through you, keep straight. But as you're going, when you're taking your steps, you kind of want to bend your knees a little so you have a momentum when you're going. And on your final step, you slide your back foot through. And most people don't lean forward, but sometimes you'll lean forward and you bring your arm through to throw the ball down the lane, of course.
Zach put me at ease, and then girls team co-captain Jenna Raypatch showed off her leadership qualities by taking some of the pressure off me.
How much extra work am I making for you guys as a team here? Like, if I was actually on your team, would you be like...
No, actually, it's not really that bad because we have to learn how to work together and support when somebody isn't doing that well on our team on that day when we go to regional or something. We got to learn to just pick them back up.
The girls' other captain, Megan Lisbinski, gives out a chill vibe, and I'm sure that helps when the pressure is on.
I call it more of a mental game because if you're not physically set or mentally set, it's going to throw your game off. It's all about keeping your mark steady and knowing what you're doing. And as long as you keep a positive attitude, that's really all there is to it.
Yep, I was ready for my strike. Kind of. I still had one more question that just had to be answered.
They told me to ask you about your hair. I mean, is that the signature thing with you?
Or? It is. It's been called the flip, the swoop, a birdcage. I don't really know. It's pretty great. I really don't even know how to explain. We need to make a video on it. Just lots of hairspray.
So you said that you were even late today a little bit.
I was. True story. I lost my hairspray bottle today. It's a travel size one, so I had to stop at Wise to get hairspray before I came here.
Okay, now I can concentrate on bowling. All I wanted was one moment where I put everything together that I learned from my very, very patient teammates. Just one moment.
Okay. say?
I'd say it was a fluke, but it really wasn't. The Cougars really helped me, and more importantly, they made me feel like part of their team. Trust yourself, trust your team, and trust your coach. Those are the words of Hazleton area head coach Sean Evans. And even though he compared me to a sumo wrestler, I'm starting to think he really knows what he's talking about. He's a great coach, but he's an even bigger fan.
It takes 1,500 revolutions to change a bad habit. You know, and I joke with the kids, I said, just think, you only have 1,499 more to go, but just think, like within 2-3 weeks, I see a change for the positive in these kids. And it's a sport that you can actually take with you the rest of your life. You know, I love it. You know, I can't bowl because of, you know, some medical issues with my knees and everything. I can still throw the ball. I can get up there and shock these kids every now and then. But living through them and their accomplishments is a phenomenal thing that I've been gifted with this group.
Oh yeah! Woo!
Coming up next, we talk with local race car driver Steve Fox about his ARCA race at the Daytona International Speedway.
Out of Left Field is brought to you in part by Coordinated Health Hazleton Campus. Better together.
The white flag is out and we're on our final lap for this episode of Out of Left Field. Steve Fox has been racing around our area for years. The Hazleton area native's successful career has brought him many places. He races every year at the Pocono Raceway as part of the ARCA series, and he's the lead instructor at Pocono's Stock Car Racing Experience. While he had quite the experience when he was asked to drive a car in the ARCA Lucas Oil 200 at the Daytona International Speedway.
You've been doing this for many years now, and all of a sudden you get the chance to go to Daytona. Did you feel like a kid again? Were you so excited?
I kept looking around for the Christmas tree because I was convinced it was Christmas morning. I mean, I was a little kid again. You know, it was everything that we thought it might be and more. We tested in January, and we went back down and did the race in February. It was just amazing. It was so different, and it was good different in every way.
Steve, there's so many race car drivers from around here, and you have been doing it for a while. You've had so much success. What would you attribute that to? I mean, is it just a commitment? And I'm sure, and I've seen, you do have some talent.
I'll take credit for a little bit of talent. Thank you. You know, it's just as you get older and you get a little bit wiser, the time that it takes to stay involved in this. I mean, not just the... You know, not just the monetary investment, but the investment in time. You know, if you talk to some of my friends and some of the people that are around me, you know, they'll wonder how I can always be on the phone. You know, you're making deals, trying to do this, trying to do that. What's coming up next? Obviously, trying to get sponsors lined up, keep the equipment in line, you know, where you're going next, trying to position yourself, to capitalize on some of the opportunities that do come along. So, I mean, most people, by the time they get to be my age, they found other things and they get tired of just working so hard. I've been blessed with the energy, and I just, you know, when I was a kid racing motorcycles, I used to fall asleep at night thinking about it, wake up the next morning thinking about it, racing motorcycles. You know, now that I'm driving, you know, race cars, I mean, even though I transitioned from two wheels to four, I still fall asleep every night thinking about it and wake up the next morning with it on my mind. So I guess that's the long answer to your short question why I'm still doing it. So.
And had to be able to live a dream at Daytona. And this started really with a great showing at Pocono last year in the ARCA race. And then you said it kind of started with the team had a driver and really just the dream. You were there for the whole process of getting this car put together that ultimately led to a top 20 finish at Daytona.
We were very fortunate to bring some people on that really helped out our program last year, 2015. They liked what they saw. We did the two Pocono races together in 2015. Showed a little promise in the first race. Second race, we drove up into the top 10, stayed there for a while, faded a little bit at the end, got our best career finish at 12th. And after that race, if the dust kind of settled, everybody involved got together for kind of a debrief of the race. And, you know, Norm Hutton, who was the guy that made this all, you know, possible, you know, came to me and said, you know, when you're here, you're driving for Tony Aquilino Universe Racing. I'd like to take Norm Hutton Racing down to Daytona. It's a dream of mine that I've had. I have some other people that share the dream with me, and you know, we'd like to put this together. You know, that conversation in August, you know, led to finding a car, and we started this November 1st, and it was really a thrash to make the t- test in January and then, you know, go back and do the race in February. So a lot happened in a real short amount of time.
Now, when I asked Dino, I said, how did Steve pull off that top 20 finish? And he said, hey, listen, he avoided those wrecks, started behind a little bit, and then you got there. Now, it sounds easier said than done. You said something interesting, though. It was a little bit easier avoiding them at Daytona than it might have been even at Pocono.
We weren't very proud of how we qualified. We had to take a provisional to get in, so we were back. I think we qualified in the next to the last row. They start 40 cars. We started 38th. So at the start, you know, everything obviously was way in front of us. There was a little bit of action on that initial start, and you know that big wreck, I guess, on lap two. By the time I got to it, I mean there were cars wrecking everywhere. There was still cars spinning around, but it wasn't that hard to kind of weave my way through. You know, after that, it wasn't a lengthy red. It was probably a red for 10 minutes or so. I mean, obviously, just had to stop for the red flag and just everybody, I think, kind of got their wits about them and settled down. There was one other moderate size wreck that took three or four guys out, but it was the race kind of went the way we thought it would. Both of our pit stops were under yellow, so there was no drama there. The pits get crowded down there at Daytona. The pits are a little tighter. It's a little harder. Both times when we pitted, the pit stalls on either side of us were full, so we really had to come in and out, you know, just on our spot. But the pit stops were good. We were good on the restarts. We didn't make any mistakes, and there were some guys having some other problems that we didn't have, and that's how, I mean, we just barely got a top 20 finish since we finished 20th, but we're still proud of it. I mean, we still advanced, you know, 18 positions. For what we're running, for what we, you know, for what we thought we could get out of that car and that engine, it's not the best combination. I mean, a lot of guys go down there, you know, and their budget is, there is no budget. It's just, what is it going to take, you know, to run as well as we can? We very much so did have a budget, and, you know, we were proud of, you know, I think we got everything out of it that we could have.
We got the car back in one piece and a possible another run at Daytona for that car next year.
Yeah, we had talked about going to Talladega, which was in April of this year, but it, you know, after we got done with Daytona and we looked at everything, and obviously some of the bills got totaled up and we ran the tally on what this all cost, Norm felt it was best to just take our limited resources and just focus on taking this car, spending a little bit of time on it every month, trying to get it the best that we can, go back to Daytona next year and try and improve on this finish. So right now, for that car, that's the plan. That's what we're going to do.
You describe what it was like. Daytona is a mecca for a lot of race car fans. You've raced a lot of places, but you said it was like nothing you've seen. What exactly was it like? How would you describe it?
Well, I don't want to say that I went down there with the wrong attitude, but as we discussed, you know, I had spent 2 weekends there instructing on the road course. And the road course uses a good portion of the oval, but you never really make a full lap on the oval. And, you know, after the first couple hours the first day, you get into the swing of things. And I had done some right seat work with some students, and I had driven a bunch of their cars. And, you know, going around there 150 miles an hour in a Ferrari, you kind of get the feel of things, and you figure you've got it, not nailed, but, you know, you think you kind of know what's ahead of you. To get, you know, to go down there and run the oval in this stock car at those speeds, you know, you're going in a corner at 190, and these stock cars are totally different than the stuff we were driving those 2 weekends. It was almost like not having been there at all. But it's just the history there. I mean, it's so fast, it's so narrow, and the banking is just, you know, you get the feeling of driving down the street, and when you get to the end of the street, instead of making the corner, you drive up on the building. That, you know, I mean, that's how extreme the banking looks. So it's wild. It's just really wild.
Well, that's going to do it for this edition of the show. Thanks a lot for watching, and please come back next time for updates on the show, like when new shows are coming up or what segments we're working on, like SSP TV's Facebook page. Take it easy, everyone.